It's Absolute Radio. My guest tonight, there's a new album from Duran Duran, and here to talk about it is Simon Le Bon. Hello.
Hi, how you doing, Jeff?
I'm doing fine. You're a bearded man at the moment.
I've been a bearded man for a while.
Have you?
Yeah, I went to India in, when was it, September or October, and everybody else had one, and I wanted one, so I decided to let it grow a little bit.
Is it the first time in all these years?
No, not really. I had quite a salty, beardy period in the early first decade. I can't bring myself to say the noughties.
No, it's a horrible word, isn't it?
The first decade, the first decade of the new millennium.
Yes.
Like, that sounds pretty bad, too.
Yeah, there's no good way to say it.
I was quite salty, though. It was quite Desperate Dan. I like to get quite full.
Yeah, quite naval.
Yeah, well, not quite naval, but the problem is that when you start finding bits remnants of last week's dinner and things it's a little off-putting.
It's good. It's like having Kendall mint cake in your pocket at all times.
Yeah. Old bits of, yeah, I know, yes. Just a fluff stuck to it.
I've noticed that you're very active on Twitter.
You're a little active, yes.
Are you enjoying that as a...
I am. I find it sort of, it appeals to the sort of the more kind of... abstract, meaningless. Well, I think people who criticise my lyric writing in the past will understand exactly what I'm talking about, because it gets a little bit kind of, yes, off the wall.
Yeah, I noticed that.
I like to just let my mind run free, free association.
Yes, stream of consciousness.
Exactly.
Stuff. Again, to drag it back down to gutter level, I was reading talking about licking peanut butter and jam.
I said something about peanut butter and jam, somebody said, "Would you, Simon Le Bon's tweets are spreading like fungus?" And I said, "I prefer to be spreading like peanut butter and red jam."
Right.
And then somebody said something else, and I said, "And for those of you who prefer to lick your peanut butter and red jam off a nicely toned stomach." I was going to say, I'm sorry, I can't help you. So what I said was, you better go to the gym and start doing yoga.
I see.
So you can go to the gym, get a flat-toned stomach and lick it off your own belly.
You're just giving advice to them. It's
exactly,
not your belly.
I'm not saying mine. No, but you know what they're like, though. The people kind of like twist it and everything.
Filthy minds.
I know, it's terrible, isn't it? It's the state of the media these days.
And do you get much in the way of insanity coming back at you?
Yeah, and I just ignore it. I mean, I've had a lot of insanity coming back at me throughout my career,
yeah.
So I've learned how to deal with it.
But you know, back in those days, though, it was sent in an envelope with scary handwriting.
Oh
on
yeah,
it
no, no. So the best one we ever got was we got a parcel, very heavy parcel, and it was in it. We opened it up, and it's a wooden box, like a wine case type box, full of sand.
And that was it.
No, that's it.
Was there a covering letter?
It was a surreal. It was a surreal message to Duran Duran from some entity.
What did you glean from it?
Pardon?
What did you glean from it?
I don't know. We didn't really glean a lot from it. We tried to make a few sandcastles, but with kind of plastic coffee cups and things.
Yeah.
It came to the office, but nobody was very successful.
You used it in the Union of the Snake video.
We could have been
sand.
We needed a bit more sand in that, didn't we? Yes. Where's the lizard? Stuck in the sand! Lizard man! In the video. Yeah, he was definitely. Oh, it's called the Union of the Snake, wasn't it? Of course. That's the one I've found the most difficult to fathom of all Duran Duran videos.
So the rest of them are fathomable?
I think so, yes.
Wild Boys.
Pardon?
Wild Boys.
I wanted to say easy for you to say, but I missed my opportunity, didn't I? Fathomable.
Why were you on that thing going round?
Because it was my idea. It was a stupid one, wasn't it? Won't do that again.
It's an elaborate way of rinsing your hair.
I know. I thought it looked quite good. It was Duran Duran playing under duress. Under duress.
I want to talk about the new album, All You Need Is Now, which I enjoyed because it sounds like Duran Duran of my youth. And Mark Ronson's produced it. He's a big fan. Was that something he was trying to get out of you?
Well, he wanted to. I mean, he you know, he's very good at sound bites, is Mark. And he said, "I want to make the third Duran Duran album that you never made." He said, "If you'd have stayed the same Duran Duran as the one that made the first album, the second, and you hadn't suffered from difficult third album syndrome, so it was second album syndrome on your third album." And you just stayed experimental. He says, because I think when I heard Seven the Ragged Tiger, it sounded like you were getting safe.
Mm.
I think I might be putting words into his mouth there, actually. That's what I think. That's actually what I think. That's what I think he ought to have said. Because nobody wants to make a record that sounds like a record that was made in 1984 or 83. You don't want to do that. But I felt that he was right in a way that we got more conventional with that album. We started making... I mean, I love stuff like... I mean, Notorious was great. That was a funky album. But Seven Ragged Tiger was safer.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted to get that danger back into the music and back into the writing more specifically. And I think he's done it really well. I mean, when we put on All You Need Is Now, it sounds edgy.
Yeah, yeah.
In the beginning, it's like, what the fuck? So, yep. Sorry, what the bleep?
Yep.
Sounds, what the hell? Third time lucky.
Well, shall we all enjoy a collective what the hell? We'll play that now. Here is from the new Duran Duran album, This Is All You Need Is Now. Simon, your motivation for making records now can't be financial. You must be, like, stinking rich.
No, because you don't pay anything.
But of course. Yeah. Who makes money out of records these days?
No, it's not. I do need to work, though. I
mean, no, you don't. You've lost. You must have millions of pounds.
I'm very greedy.
What's the last thing that you wanted to spend your money on that you couldn't afford?
There's been some nice cars in the car auctions.
Really?
Things like, you know, 1929 Blower Bentleys and things, which are just way beyond me.
Oh.
Way, way beyond me.
Listeners will now be like going through their small
Alfa Romeo
change.
And- 8C, yes.
We'll have people at home going down the back of the settees.
Do a quick rip round for me, and then I can have my classic car, which Yasmin will drive.
So why? I mean, is it the thrill of making something, or is it playing live that still holds the most excitement?
It's a lot of both. There's something very special about the writing process, because especially when you do what we did this time, which is to try and not be conventional, just to forget about the rules and to just do what you want to and make songs which maybe start with a chorus and then go into a middle late, and then rather than do the conventional verse chorus middle end chorus out.
Yeah.
And also, you know, playing around with tonality and atonality and that kind of approach makes it very much more exciting. You do feel a little insecure at first, but it can, you know, we ended up with the best possible results from it.
So did you find that prior to this, maybe you'd found a formula for songwriting?
I think you just tend to go into not formulas, I don't want the wrong word, but you tend to repeat patterns, don't you? Whatever you do, especially if it's something that's been successful. And we do have very, 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 very strong pop instincts. You know, we were working on we call them B-sides, but they're not really, they're extra tracks.
Yeah.
We were working on some yesterday in the studio, and we started with this very out there piece of music. But I mean, as soon as I sung something that sounded like a chorus, and he went, that's it, no, do that and double it and put some harmonies on it and all that stuff. And I did it, and I could just feel it kind of getting, you know, becoming radio friendly.
Yeah.
From being,
but it's funny, cause I think Duran always sort of sneaked in a bit of something other than mainstream pop by stealth, really. If you listen to the harmonies on a lot of your records, they're not discordant, but they're not the obvious.
No, absolutely. I mean, harmonies, and also, I mean, you know, if you listen to our first album, we were a club band.
Yeah.
We were a band who played to an audience of over 18s. We were an arts, you know, half of it was an art school band. Nick and John were arts, came straight out of art school.
I see the girls on film videos, high art.
Yes, I do too.
Not just a bit of tawdry publicity.
Tawdry publicity and a nipple and an ice cube. Yeah. I know. It all went downhill from there.
Talk about live performance. How has that changed over the years?
It's become more of a serious occupation, actually.
It kind of used to be what
we used to do before the party.
Yeah.
And we couldn't hear it either.
Yeah.
Do I rue it?
Yeah,
it's become more serious.
Yeah.
I love it. I mean, I love being, I never thought, I think I kind of grew up thinking that we weren't proper artists. You know, I knew we could write music, but as to performing it, as because we could never hear ourselves, we didn't know how good you could be as a performer if you put a lot of hours in practicing.
Yeah.
I love getting on stage now and having the kind of power to affect people with music, to affect their emotions and to take them on a ride, you know, and have them quiet and then bring them up and get them dancing and then get them singing along with us. It's a fantastic thing. I love that aspect of it.
That sounds a lot like megalomania.
Huh?
That sounds a lot like megalomania.
People have been saying that for a long time about my band. An awful long time. Do I miss the partying? I do, yeah, because it was a lot of fun. But you can't, you know, your life changes and you change. And I might be a pretty sad guy if I was still doing the same things I did when I was 21. You know?
So how does your hedonism manifest itself in these days?
I don't know if I'm that hedonistic, really. Not particularly.
Where'd you get your kicks?
I was never very addictive, so I never really got into drugs in a big way or alcohol. Probably, you know, a couple of beers would be my problem more than anything else. I never really kind of fell into those pitfalls that people, you know.
So what's thrilling
about
to you then?
What's thrilling?
Outside of your job?
Speed. I like speed, sport. You know, I race motorbikes. Had a painful season doing racing bikes. Drive a bit too fast.
Yeah.
I stopped by a copper last night, actually.
Were you really?
Yeah.
Were you able to pull the Duran Duran card?
I didn't try that. I was truly humble. And humbled. I mean, I was going too fast. So that's all there is to it.
How fast?
I don't know. That's the worst thing. Right, I wasn't even really looking. Yeah. And it was in little side streets as well. But the guy, you know, because I've got kids. And he said that. He said, "You got kids?" I said, "Yeah, I know. I knew what he was going to say, of course, you know." Yeah. And it just brings you back down to earth. That's what happens with me, with bikes and racing as well. I get faster. As soon as I stop racing, I get faster and faster and faster, and then maybe have a little scary moment, and it slows you down.
Yeah.
You know, that scary moment is the same as having a policeman put his finger at you and make you stop, actually.
Yeah. Would you like to go to the moon or into space?
Yeah, but not in the way they do it now. I mean, I want to go on one of those amazing spaceships where you have got an incredibly good-looking crew. And
you're
they
thinking
all wear,
of the Starship
and they all
Enterprise.
Wear, like, you know, I'm thinking of science fiction books and things. You know, and you go off for years and you find other kind. You find, you know, you find some race that shows you how to do immortality and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a bit of a disappointment going to the International Space Station.
Yeah. Who are the personnel in the band at the moment?
Simon Le Bon, that's
present.
Me. Nick Rhodes.
Yeah. How's he, Nick Rhodes?
He's very well. He's forever high spirited and.
Oh God, that must get annoying.
No. He's not in the way that you think.
Right.
He sounds like quite a pessimist actually, but he isn't really. No, he's a real optimist. I mean, let me go through the guys as well. Anyway, so it's John Taylor's playing bass.
Has he lost his looks?
No.
Oh, makes me sick.
It sounds so annoying, isn't it?
Isn't it? Yeah.
It's so annoying. Yeah. Roger Taylor on drums. He hasn't lost his looks either. And we've got Don Brown has stepped in to play guitar since we parted company with Andy Taylor.
But that's good. 80% original members at
exactly.
this stage of the proceedings is good going. And you all like each other?
Yes, we all like each other. We're all in very, very, very high spirits at the moment because we know we've got a good album. It's strong.
Well, best of luck with it.
Thank you.
As I said before, I enjoyed listening to it very much and enjoyed getting out there on tour.
Cool. Thanks a lot.